more. Father, thank you so much, Lord, that you are here in this room. You are moving, Father, right from the very beginning, Lord. You have set already the stage. You're about to declare your power, your glory, your mercy and grace in this room, O God. And we are opening our hearts, our mind, O God, all our whole being, Father. We are ready, O God, and we are anticipating, O God, for what you are about to do in our midst, God. God, we came here, Father, with different attitude. We came here with different expectations, Lord. We have a different agenda, O God. And right from this very moment, God, let our agenda be your agenda, Father. We would like to hear from you. Open our eyes, open our mind, open our hearts that we may see and hear, Lord, your word, your very word to this church, to every individual in this room. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. I hope this is working. The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of His hands. I'm so fascinated with the hand of God this week and past few months. I always encounter the word God's hand in the Bible. Not just in New Testament, but also in Old Testament. My reading for nowadays is in Old Testament. The hand of God seems always there. And it declares the glory of God, and it proclaims the work of His hand. In Psalms 95:5, it says there, the sea is His. He made it, and His hand formed the dry land. Imagine the hand of God. It's powerful, full of authority. In Isaiah 48, verse 13, it says, my own hand laid the foundations of the earth. God is speaking here, church. Listen very carefully. And my right hand spread out the heavens. When I summon them, they all stand up together. They all follow the hand of God. And the last verse that I would like to show you is in Job 12, verse 10. In His hand is the life of every creature in the breath of all mankind. I would like to talk about today, church, is about the hand of God. And I would like to entitle the message today, The Mighty Hand of God. The hand of God that we are going to hear today, it's not the physical hand of God, but it is a figure of speech, which means God's power and God's authority. I love to be in the hand of God. Who doesn't want to be in the hand of God? After reading those verses that we've read a while ago, who doesn't want to be in the hand of God? I would like to hear somebody say, oh, Pastor Jun is in the hand of God. Oh, his ministry is in the hand of God. Life Expressions Fellowship, the hand of God is upon you. Isn't that great that we have that kind of experience, that we have that kind of situation, that we can experience the hand of God? When you say the hand of God is in you, you have the approval of God. When you say that the hand of God is in you, you have the power of God. You have the authority of God. The authority of God rests on you. So I would like us to learn today, church, the hand of God in our lives. Not just an ordinary hand, but it is a mighty hand of God. Who wants to be in the hand of God today? Do you want your relationship to be in the hand of God? Do you want to be your health, your situation, your future to be in the hand of God? After reading those verses, those powerful verses that we read, there was one person written in the Bible. He was mentioned so many times in the book of Ezra. Who knows who's this? Of course, Ezra. In the book of Ezra, Ezra was mentioned. He was mentioned that the hand of God was upon him. The Ezra came from Babylon. He was a teacher, well-versed in the law of Moses, which the Lord, the God of Israel, had given to give you a little background, church, Babylon, this is the place where they were being captive. They were captives in this nation. Because of the Jewish disobedience, because of their wickedness, they were brought to Babylon. This was the punishment of God to the people of Israelites. And there was a prophecy of Jeremiah that they would stay on the land of Babylon for 70 years. So I hope you're following me. This was a prophecy that this Jewish people would stay on Babylon for 70 years as their punishment. So they were there. This Ezra came from Babylon. He was a teacher, well-versed in the law of Moses, which the Lord, the God of Israel, had given. The king had granted him everything he asked for the hand of the Lord, his God, was on him. Imagine, he was in the land of Babylon. We don't really know what happened to him day by day in the land of Babylon. But I know this place wasn't his place. His place was, of course, Jerusalem, Israel. They were foreigners in this land. But in this burst, everything that he asked, the king granted him, because the Lord's God, the God's hand was on him. On verse 8, we'll continue reading it. Ezra arrived in Jerusalem in the fifth month of the seventh year of the king. He had begun his journey from Babylon on the first day of the first month, and he arrived in Jerusalem on the first day of the fifth month, for the gracious hand of God was with him. So how many months he traveled? 4 months he traveled. There's no Jetstar during that time. There's no Air New Zealand. There's no boat. There's no cars. They traveled from Babylon, 1,000 miles from Babylon to Jerusalem. And they reached, and they arrived Jerusalem safely, for the gracious hand of God was on him. So do you understand, or do you get the background, the thing that I would like to share to you? And we could learn from our scripture today that Ezra experienced God's hand from Babylon, the place of their captivity. Going back to Jerusalem, the promised land. Let me tell you this. You came here today, church. You came here today. I don't know your situation. Maybe you are in your own Babylon. But you can experience the hand of God in your Babylon. And that hand of God can lead you to your Jerusalem, the promised land. And God could lead you to God's promise, the fulfillment of God's promise in your life. So now I would like to ask you again, who wants to be in the hand of God, if this is the case? After hearing that Ezra experienced the blessing, the things from the king, pagan king, because God's hand was on him, I would like this church to be in the hand of God. If the hand of God will not be in this church, I don't want to be the pastor of this church. I don't want to attend this church. If the hand of God, even for a single minute or 1 minute or a single second, that the hand of God will remove his hand in this church, I don't want to be part of this church. I don't want to live my life if the hand of God is not with me. May it be our prayer today, church, for our family, for our future, for our schools, for our workplace, that the hand of God is with us. The hand of God would be upon your workplace, your relationship, your plans? That's our desire. So how did Ezra experience the hand of God? Do you have any idea? How did Ezra experience the hand of God? If you're going to continue reading on verse 10, there's the answer. Verse 10 says, "For Ezra had set his heart to study the law of the Lord and to practice it and to teach statutes and ordinances in Israel." That's the reason why Ezra experienced the hand of God in his life. Four things that I would like you to see on this verse. The reason why Ezra experienced the hand of God. First is, set your heart with God quickly. I would like you to experience the hand of God in your life. All you need to do is first set your heart with God. We do not experience the hand of God in our lives because our heart is not set with God. You know, we're not talking about the heart that pumps gallons of blood to operate in our body. What we are talking about here is the inner core or the whole being. Our mind, our emotion, our will, that's the heart. No, set your heart with God because out of the overflow of your heart, the mouth speaks. What's in your heart, that's what you do. That's what you think. That's what you create in your life. That's why let your heart be set with God. Is your heart right now set with God? Lord, I would like to experience the hand, Lord, that you promised, that you let Ezra experience. I would like to experience that hand. But let me ask you the question. Is your heart right now set with God? That's a good question, right? We can attend all Bible studies. We could attend all the libraries, all the prayer meetings, all the Sunday service. We could do this, all the stuff here without our heart being set with God. This is a good starting point right now. We have to set our hearts right. Second thing that you need to do, when your heart is set with God, you have to study the Word of God. Here you are again, Pastor Jun, teaching us again to read or study the Word of God. Yes, church. Again, I would like to tell you this. If you would like to grow, listen to me. You study the Word of God. Don't be satisfied just coming on Sunday listening to Pastor Jun or to the elders or the visiting speakers here for you to hear the Word of God. You have the responsibility as a child of God to read the Word of God of your Father in heaven. You need to listen. You need to not just read about it, study the Word of God. Because from there, you would know the plans of God in your life. Not only study it, but thirdly, you have to practice it. Many of us, we love studying, but we are weak or we are poor on obeying the Word of God. Seems quiet here in this room. Obeying the Word of God is the key to blessing. Whether you like it or not, you are going to read many times, many verses in the Bible that says you are going to be blessed if you are going to obey the Word of God. And how would you obey something that you don't know? Then you have to study the Word of God. I can imagine Ezra, his heart was set with God. He's studying the Word of God. He obeyed the Word of God. And not only he obeyed God, but he also shared the Word of God. These four things that we could find from Ezra, this is the reason why he experienced the hand of God in his life. For Ezra had set his heart to study the law, to practice it, teach it, and share the Word of God. Many of us, we would like to study, but we don't have the right heart with it. Many of us would like to share the Word of God, but we don't obey it. We just would like to share it, but we don't want to obey the Word of God by ourselves. But now, how can the word, how can God's hand move in our lives if we are not obeying the word of God? So these are the four things that I would like to share to you. But we're not yet finished. But this is very crucial, church. This is very crucial. I would like the hand of God to be in this church, to be upon every leaders of this church, every small group leaders, every person attending in this church. I would like to see the hand of God manifesting in the lives of His people. You know what happened if you are going to experience the hand of God in your life? Let's continue reading. If the mighty hand of God is in your life, this is what you're going to experience. Are you ready? Now, I decree that any of the Israelites in my kingdom, including priests and Levites, who volunteer to go to Jerusalem with you, may go. You are sent by the king and his seven advisors to inquire about Judah and Jerusalem with regard to the law of your God, which is in your hand. This is very clear, church, that God, if the mighty hand of God in your life, God can open doors. We have studied last week about open doors. I've given you the background a while ago. The reason why I gave you the background a while ago, because it has something to do with this. Of course, the Israelites who were living in Jerusalem for 70 years, they could have forgotten the prophecy that they would only stay there for 70 years. They could have lived there comfortably. Perhaps they forgot the prophecy that they're going out of Babylon after 70 years, and now it's already 70 years. And the pagan king himself said, now I decree that any of the Israelites in my kingdom, including priests and Levites, who volunteer to go to Jerusalem with you, may go. Perhaps King Cyrus just woke up one morning and said, God touched my heart. I'm going to let this Israelite go home to the land of the promise, to Jerusalem. It's already 70 years, actually. This is the fulfillment of Jeremiah's prophecy that they would go home to Jerusalem. Isn't it? Because the hand of God was upon Ezra, was upon the Israelites, they saw an open door. I can call this an open door for them. I didn't see any scripture that says that they're asking the king for the king to bring them back to Jerusalem. I didn't see any scripture about that. This is what just I learned. The king just let these people go back to Jerusalem. You may go, priests, Levites. This is an open door. When the hand of God is in your life, you will experience open door. You don't have to force your way in. You don't have to unlock that door if it's already locked. If God's hand is upon your life, you will experience open door. I was comfortably ministering in Japan for last 17 years ago. You know, many of you heard already my testimony on this area, but many of you new in this church, you don't know my testimony about it. I was ministering there for 17 years ago. I was ministering in Japan. All of a sudden, a friend of mine told me about New Zealand. New Zealand? Is there a country such as New Zealand? Where is that? I didn't know what New Zealand is. And after that, after 5 years, I went back to the Philippines because of immigration matters. I finished my mission in Japan. And then this friend of mine, again, he told me about New Zealand. God, are you opening some doors? Or are you telling me, Lord, to go to New Zealand? But I was worried about going to New Zealand because I know that my qualification won't give me the right points that would give me the residency. But I could feel the hand of God leading me in this land. it's impossible for me to come here. And my points, all this blah, blah, blah. But God opened door. He led me here. That's why we're here. We didn't force it, actually. God just opened doors. One door to another. He opened door. If God is upon your life, God's hands upon your life, He would open doors for you. Don't force yourself into a relationship or to a job or to a ministry or a place without God's hand. Don't force to open that door. But be careful. There are open doors that doesn't come from that don't come from God, actually. You may say, oh, Pastor Jun, this person just came to me. I think this is an open door. This is an open opportunity. I am going to grab it. I think this is mine. I think this is from the Lord. I think I should grab it, Pastor Jun. Be careful. It doesn't mean that if it is open, it is coming from God. But you would know if it is from God, if the hand of God is in you. How? When you read the Bible, we will go back how Ezra experienced the hand of God. He set his heart right. He studied the Word of God. And he obeyed the Word of God. And he shared it. If you are going to set your heart right with God, you would know that the hand of God is in that relationship, is in that work, is in that job, is in that place or ministry or church. Be careful. What I'm telling here, church, if God's hand is upon you and you are sure with it, God will open doors for you. Secondly, if God opened door for you, look what happened to Ezra. Following verse. Moreover, you are to take with you the silver and gold. Who's speaking here? The king, pagan king. Moreover, you are to take with you silver and gold. Silver and gold, if the mighty hand of God is in your life, He would open door and He would provide for you. See, the pagan king. Moreover, you are to take with you the silver and gold that the king and his advisors have freely given to the God of Israel, whose dwelling is in Jerusalem. God, the king knows what's their need. That's why he said, you could bring these things for your dwelling in Jerusalem together with all the silver and gold you may obtain from the province of Babylon, as well as the freewill offerings of people and priests for the temple. With this money, be sure to buy bulls, rams, male lambs, and sacrifice and them on the altar, on the temple of your God in Jerusalem. Meaning to say, if God's hand is upon you, you will have provisions. Yes, He will not just open doors for you. He would also provide for your needs in order for you to go to be successful in fulfilling His promise and getting that thing for you. Silver and gold. If the Bible speaks of silver and gold, that is massive. That is huge. That is big. This is coming from a pagan king. We didn't have money when we applied for New Zealand. You can ask my wife. Who had money when you applied for New Zealand? Many of you got money here, right? But not us. We didn't have that enough money for us to go through all this processing, all these fees, NCQA, all these things, IELTS, you know what I'm saying, right? I know you could relate on this. We didn't have enough money when we applied for New Zealand. Looking back, church, I didn't know how we were able to manage to pay all these fees. And the fact that our kids, they were still studying in private schools. How can I manage that? I'm just working by myself and my wife just taking care of our kids at home. Lovely wife. But my salary was just enough for our everyday expenses. How were we able? Because my God opened door for me and He supplied for all my needs. God provided for everything, and we even had enough money to live in New Zealand for 3 months. You know what I mean? 3 months. You should have enough money to live in New Zealand for 3 months. Yes, we have that enough money. Oh, my sister just lend me the money. It's not actually my money. But the point is, God provided for my needs because He knew that we cannot do it by ourselves. Yes, when we arrived here, just to give you a little history of mine, yes, we had enough money for 3 months to live. But God provided us right away. Provided me, and within 3 weeks, He gave me a job. Not only that, He gave us a free house to stay. 3 months as well, free. And then He gave us friends to help us to settle here in New Zealand. Free as well. That's the hand of God. God can use the pagan king, King Cyrus, to provide for the Israelites in order for them to experience the fulfillment of God's promise. And God can use even the pagan king, pagan boss, pagan employers, pagan friends, you know, in order for you to experience the God's provision, in order for you to experience the fulfillment of God's promise in your life, He could use your friends. He could use people around you. Yes, you cannot see the hand of God, those people, those employers or bosses or coworkers, they are God's hand, extension of God's hand. You know, God's hand is in your life right now. So do not be afraid in your situation. Do not be afraid. You will not lack of any good thing. He will supply all your needs according to His riches and glory in Christ Jesus. That's a promise. So the hand of God should be upon your life. And if God's hand is in your life, let's continue reading. First, God will open door. Second, He will provide. Thirdly, now I, King Artaxerxes, decree that all the treasures of Trans Euphrates are to provide with diligence whatever Ezra, the priest, the teacher of the law of the God of heaven, may ask of you, up to 100 talents of silver, 100 cores of wheat, 100 vats of wine, 100 vats of olive oil and salt without limit. What are we talking about here, Pastor Jun? The king decreed to all the treasurers of Trans-Euphrates. Trans-Euphrates means those are the provinces beyond the rivers. This is the river, the provinces that they would pass and that they would be associated with. God decreed on them that they should give honor or give diligence to whatever Ezra the priest, the teacher of the law, may ask of them. So I could see here, as we continue in verse 27 to 28, praise be to the Lord, the God of our ancestors, who has put into the king's heart to bring honor to the house of the Lord in Jerusalem in this way, and He has extended His good favor. Imagine a pagan king who didn't know about God gave favor to Israelites, to the Jewish people, in order for them to go back to Jerusalem. If God's hand is upon your life right now, expect that God's favor is upon you. It's not just God would open doors. It's not just God will provide for you. He would extend His favor. The ancestor was put in the king's heart. God can touch the heart of kings. God can touch the hearts of the people around you in order for Him to express His favor in your life. Have you experienced the favor of God in your life? If not, desire for the hand of God in your life. Favor comes from God. He can use people such as king, officials, all these people around you. God could use these people just for Him to express His favor in your life. You know, children of God, you are favored. You are highly favored. Just as being a child of God, you are highly favored already. Let's continue reading. If the mighty hand of God is in your life, you will have favor from God. Next, because the hand of the Lord, what is he saying? Because the hand of the Lord, my God, was on me, I took courage and gathered leaders from Israel to go up with me. If the hand of God is in you, what should you learn from this? You should take courage. You should take courage. Ezra was so sure that the hand of God was on him. And that gave him confidence. He gathered leaders from Israel to go up with him. Without God, I don't have any confidence to stand up here. Without God's hand upon me, I don't have any confidence to lead this church. But if you know that God's hand is upon you, you should take courage. You should know the will of God. You should know the Word of God, and that Word of God would lead you, would carry you through to, in order for you to fulfill His will. If you know that the favorable hand of God is upon your life, be confident that you can move that mountain that you are facing. Though people around you say you cannot make it, or it is impossible, my friend. It is very hard for you to do that. But if you are confident that God's hand is upon you, do not back down. Do not be afraid. Many stop growing. Many stop advancing. Many stop from growing. Why? Because they believe that what Satan is saying about them, those lies, the enemy is instilling those doubts, those fear in your heart. Do not believe in that. If you know that the hand of God is in your life, take courage. Be confident. Be confident. The hand of God will give you confidence. If you know that the Prime Minister or President Trump is approving what you're doing, maybe you're confident to do what you have to do, right? What more? The bosses of the bosses, the presidents of the presidents, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He has His hand upon you. He has the approval in your life. So you have to be confident in what you're doing. If God's hand is in your life, He will open door. Maybe you're waiting for an open door. Remember, God will provide, and He will give you favor, and you will have confidence. And last point that I would like to share, I was ashamed to ask for soldiers. Ezra speaking, the horsemen to protect us from enemies and the Lord on the road, because we had told the king, the gracious hand of our God is on everyone who looks to Him. But His great anger is against all who forsake Him. So we fasted and petitioned our God about this, and He answered our prayer. They were ashamed to ask God for a protection. Why? Because they brag to the king, oh, God's hand is upon us. And He looks to Him, everyone who looks to Him, but His great anger is against all who forsake Him. Meaning to say, they were ashamed of asking the king because they were already bragged that God is with them, that God will protect them. They can no longer ask. And what they did? They fasted. They petitioned our God about this, and He answered our prayer. Imagine the danger this people, Israel, with Ezra, imagine the danger they were facing. They're carrying how many tons of gold? It didn't mention, but they were carrying golds, silvers, tons, and they were traveling for 4 months. 1,000 miles. Imagine the danger that you would experience along the road from Babylon to Jerusalem. Can you walk that long with gold and silver in your hand or in your caravan without any help or any protection? Ezra knew that they needed protection. They should have asked the king for a soldier, soldiers or horsemen to protect them. But they weren't able to ask. So they just fasted and prayed, but God answered them. Perhaps you're not carrying gold or silver right now, but what I could tell you right now is you are carrying treasures with you, and that the enemy, the devil, Satan, he doesn't want that. You are carrying a treasure. Yes, maybe it's not silver or gold, but you are carrying a treasure. You know, in 2 Corinthians 4, what's the treasure? You are carrying Jesus. You are an earthen vessel. You are a clay. You are a clay. You are carrying Jesus. And God, and the enemy, Satan, doesn't want you to carry Jesus, His gospel. And that's why the enemy is trying to stop us from fulfilling God's promise and will in our lives. He would do anything to stop you down, to stop you and pull you down. But in this verse, on the 12th day of the first month, after they fasted and they prayed to God, after they fasted, on the 12th day of the first month, we set out from Ahaba Canal to go to Jerusalem. The hand of our God was on us, and He protected us from enemies and bandits along the way. Ezra humbled himself to God. The Israelites humbled themselves to God by fasting and praying. I don't know how you would humble yourself to God in order for you to experience the hand of God in your life. And because of their humility, because they fasted, because they prayed, because God saw their humility, God answered their prayer. And the hand of God protected them. The hand of God wasn't us, and He protected us. Perhaps God opened door for you, and you are on your way to fulfill and to grab that thing, that job, that ministry, that relationship, that person. God's hand is in your life. He would provide. He would open doors for you. He would provide, and you will receive favor from God. The point that I am trying to give His church is very simple. Actually, just one point. You have to have the hand of God in your life. In everything that you do, you should have the hand of God. And we have to humble ourselves to God by knowing His word and observing it as we have read a while ago. You know what? We experience trouble today, nowadays, not because God's hand is not upon our lives. It's actually, God's hand is always present. Even you experience trouble, even experience hardship. Because instead of God leading us, giving us breakthrough blessings, if you are not going with the hand of God, He's opposing you. Listen to this. God opposes the proud and gives grace to the humble. That's what Ezra and the Israelites did. They humbled themselves. They fasted. They prayed. They humbled themselves. But on the first part of this verse, as Peter said, He opposes the proud If we will remain proud, God will oppose us. I'm not proud, Pastor Jun. I'm actually humbling myself to God. But when you don't receive, but when you don't read your Bible, it's just like saying, I am not with you, God. I can live without you. If you're not reading the Word of God, if you're not studying the Word of God, you are saying, I can live without God. But when you read the Word of God, that's a sign of humility. Because you're saying, God, I cannot live without you. I need your direction. I need your leading. You know how God treats the humble, the proud, right? He opposes the proud. That's why when you experience the hand of God right now in your life, you say, Lord, your hand is so heavy upon me, God. What's happening, Lord? Perhaps you're becoming proud. That's why you need to humble yourself, therefore, and God's mighty hand, that He may lift you up in due time. This is the day that we need to consider this. We have to humble ourselves to God. Yes, the hand of God will always be upon us, no matter what. But sometimes, it is a hand of correction. It is a hand of training. It is a hand of discipline or redirection. But don't think that God's hand is not upon you if you're still waiting for God for so long and He's not answering your prayer requests. Don't think that God's hand is not upon you. Perhaps He's shaping you. He's preparing you to receive the best. God won't settle for good. He would like the best for you. Remember, God is our potter and we are the clay. And we are all the work of His hand. You're experiencing right now tough times. Perhaps you're experiencing the shaping of God. He's forming you to the kind of person He wants you to be. Still, God's hand is upon you, but preparing you for something big, something great. Can we all stand? Let this be our prayer, church, today, that the mighty hand of God will be upon this church. Let this be our prayer today, church, that the mighty hand of God will be upon our families, will be upon our lives, in our workplace, in our personal lives. As Ezra experienced these five things, I'm sure you could also experience this in your life. You are going to set your heart with God. If you are going to study His Word, if you are going to obey His Word, if you are going to share the Word of God to others. Lord, we would like to have and experience the mighty hand of God in our lives. We cannot do it by ourselves, Lord. We are tired of doing it by ourselves. We are tired of waiting, O God. We are tired, Lord, of seeing things, Father, that's not being productive, Lord. But thank you. Thank you, Lord, for this moment that we now realize, O God, without the mighty hand of God in our lives, everything, Lord, will be meaningless. Everything, O God, will be unfruitful. That's why today, you're here and your heart is not set with God. First thing you need to do is to set your heart right with God. If you're here today, you would like to set your heart right with God, I'm challenging you. Make a decision. Set your heart right with God. Oh, Holy Spirit, we ask you, Lord, to move in our midst, to move in this church, Lord. There's any heart right now that is not right before you, O Lord. Touch it, O God. Mold it, shape it, O God, according to the kind of heart that you would like to see to your people. And help us to be hungry, O God, for your word. That as we read your word, we are going to see, O God, you more and more, and we are going to grow deeper, O God, in our relationship with you. Lord, as we obey your word, O God, help us to see, O God, the fruit, O God, of obeying you. And as we obey you, O God, we are going to experience more of your power, more of your grace. And Lord, help us, God, to share your word to others. The blessing that we've been receiving from you, help us, Lord, to share it to others. Hallelujah. If you're here right now, if you would like to set your heart with God, if you're that person, I would like to see that hand. You would like to have the hand of God in your family, raise your hand. Thank you for that hand. Thank you for those hands. If you would like to see the hand of God in your relationship, raise your hand. You're not raising your hand to me. You're raising your hand to God. Raising your hand is a sign of surrender, sign of humility, not a sign of weakness. If you would like to see the hand of God in your workplace, in your future, in your son, your daughter, your children, this church, I know all of us, we need that. Father, right now, you can see the cry of the hearts of your people. We would like to see the hand of God in our lives, oh God, in our church, Lord. Father, we don't want to go on in this life without your hands being bestowed upon us, God. We would like to experience, oh God, what Ezra experienced in the Bible. We would like to experience, oh God, open doors. We would like to experience, God, the provision of the Father in heaven. We would like to experience the favor of God in heaven. We would like to experience, God, the protection of Father in heaven. We would like to experience, Lord, more confidence in us, oh God, as we acknowledge, oh God, that your hand is upon us. Thank you, God. Thank you. Believe right now, church, that you are going to step out on that open door that God is preparing for you. God, thank you so much, Lord. We are going to hear testimonies this week, oh God, that doors are being opened, Lord. Provisions are overflowing, Father. We are going testimony, oh God. We are going to hear testimony this week, oh God. That favor, oh God, is overflowing, Father. We are going to experience, oh God, this week, oh God. Confidence is overflowing, oh God. And protection, oh God, is upon your people. We give you praise, Lord. We give you glory. There is an overflow in the Spirit. There is overflow in the heavenly realm, church. Come on, let's expect overflow in our church, in our family, in our finances, in our health. There is an overflow. God is without limit. God is without limit. The mighty hand of God can bestow blessing upon your life. God is without limit.